This is the Confessional Bibliology Podcast. It'll be the first of a series that I'm hoping to get out once a week on Wednesday or Thursday. And the purpose of this podcast is to cover the differences between the confessional view of Scripture as espoused by the Reformers versus the modern view. And I say modern view, but you have to understand this modern view originated with the Roman Catholics as an attack on the doctrine of sola scriptura. And before then, it had its precursors amongst a man known as John Goodwin, who the Reformer has labeled the Grand Heretic of England. These are things you should keep in mind as we go forward, that the position held by those who affirmed the critical text was considered heresy by the Reformers. All right, welcome to the introductory section, in which we'll discuss the issue that we're going to cover this week, along with some announcements. So let's get right into it. This week, the first podcast, we're going to discuss how you can know for sure whether or not Scripture is truly the Word of God. And I don't mean, is it part of it the Word of God, or some of it, but not other parts, or this version might be the Word of God, but we're not really sure. No, you will know for sure that the Textus Receptus and the Masoretic Hebrew texts are the Word of God as God originally gave them to you, to us. So, the second part of the introductory section is the announcements. And we have two good announcements this week. My fingers aren't in the camera. There we go. I guess my camera's over here. Anyways, two announcements this week. The first announcement is, on October 2nd and 3rd, we will have the debate between James White and Dr. Jeffrey Riddle. Now, the first one will be over Mark 16, 9 through 20, and the second will be over Ephesians 3, 9. This will be interesting to go over, because if Mr. White were truly consistent in his view, as he accuses us of being inconsistent, then he would actually affirm that Mark 16, 9 through 20 is Scripture. After all, we have it going back. Far back. And based upon textual criticism, it seems that we would want to include it. We know that the Codices Vaticanus and Sinaiticus, B and Aleph respectively, both contain gaps at the end of Mark chapter 16 where you could fit that text. So it'll be interesting to see. Now, Ephesians 3:9, Mr. White will claim that we don't have real manuscript evidence to support it. Here's the problem with that argumentation. And this is where we'll get into the section of our main issue for this week, how you can know Scripture is Scripture. All right, let's go ahead and get right into the main subject. How do we know that we have the Scriptures? How do you know that the Bible you have is the Word of God? And that's a really a complex question. The better question that we should ask ourselves is, how do we know that the authentic Greek and Hebrew text, as our confession says, is the authentic Word of God? And when we hold up that Greek and Hebrew text, how do we know with surety that every word that God spoke to us that he wanted recorded is in there? And this is an important question you have to ask yourself. Are there errors in it? Is there texts that have been added that aren't Scripture? Have texts been lost over time? So we had texts that were Scripture, but we no longer know what they are because they were lost over time, and maybe they might be discovered in the future. That's the problem with restorationist textual criticism. In its core, it is atheism, because it assumes that God's inspiration did not continue through history. You see, preservation is part of God's inspiration. So when you deny providential preservation, as people like James White and Dr. Michael Kruger do, you are denying the doctrine of inspiration. You cannot have one without the other. And you cannot hold to a general preservation like James White does. The puzzle pieces analogy, I'm sure many of you have heard of it if you followed him at any length. That's not the analogy Scripture gives. Scripture tells us, as our confession states, that God's word has been kept pure in all ages by a singular care and providence. And that has logical consequences for us. Nothing's been lost, and nothing's been added to it. the text we have today in the Textus Receptus and the Benkei Masoretic text is the text that God originally gave, without addition and without subtraction. And you might ask yourself, well, how can I make such a bold claim? Because that's what Scripture requires of us. You see, a lot of people don't think through the logical ramifications of what is necessary in order to approach the issue of textual criticism, not even those who hold to the restorationist view. In fact, I would say that it is only those of us on the confessional view who have even begun to think what is necessary. And for those of you who have read Dr. Theodore Leas's ecclesiastical text and some of his other works, you hear him make that comment, or read him make that comment. Here, if you've seen the video series that is on YouTube, there's three of them in it. You can watch it. I'll put a link to the page for Dr. Theodore Leas along on the page that goes with this video on the website. But the issue that we have before us is, how do we know that we have the Scriptures? What is the foundation for our knowing? Now, people like James White, and I bring him up a lot because he's the most popular version of the confessional, or not the confessional, excuse me, the critical view of Scripture. And he's the person that those laymen who hold to the critical view with a naivete, let's face it, that they do so because they listen to James White, which over the time of this podcast, as we go into analysis of some of the arguments put forth by him and others, you'll see that it is an extremely foolish thing to listen to Mr. White on this issue because of his habit of lying, bearing false witness, and just putting forth shoddy scholarship and bad information. But let's get back to it. How do we know that we have the Scriptures? In other words, what is the ultimate authority by which we evaluate the Greek manuscripts and the differences between them? Let's say we have two Greek manuscripts, and let's say we only had two, make it simple, or 10, and each of them differed a little bit. Let's say there were 1,000 differences between 10 manuscripts. How do we know which one's which? Which one is the correct reading? That's a good question. And it's a question that critical text advocates never really think through. So let's assume the position of the critical text advocate for the sake of argument. We'd have to use textual criticism. And in textual criticism, we'd have to have a way of evaluating the manuscripts. So we would say that the harder reading is to be preferred because we think that it is more likely that a scribe would try to massage a text to make it easier, you know, grammatically easier. And so the easier text is obviously the one the scribe's corrupted, and the harder text is obviously the one that's true. But that assumes things that you cannot prove. And this is perhaps the biggest problem with the whole critical text argument. Mountain upon mountain of assumption that cannot be proved. And that is not the confessional view of Scripture. That is not the biblical view of Scripture. Scripture tells us certain things about itself. It tells us that it is kept pure in all ages, that God's inspiration continues throughout history because God preserves his text pure. This is an important type of thing to understand here. And for those of you who aren't big readers and haven't read this book, you need to get it. It goes through what the Westminster divines and those who followed in their footsteps, such as the Baptists with the 1689 Confession of Faith, what these people held to when they said that Scripture was kept pure in all ages. It wasn't just a generic purity or a purity that you couldn't read. In other words, the modern view, the Warfieldian view, which Milne goes into and Theodore Leas before him went into, is the idea that Scripture hasn't been kept pure over time. Not in the strict sense that the confession and the divines meant. I know it seems I'm rambling, but I'm getting to a point that I hope you'll give some serious consideration And the reason for this, most people don't think through the logical ramifications. And most people think you need to know a whole bunch of stuff in order to even begin to discuss this issue. You'll see this in some of the Facebook groups that deal with it. You'll have people who think that they're textual critics, that they really know what's going on. They'll make definitive claims. You see this with James White. I'll bring him up quite a bit because he's the perfect example of an entire group of people who are very poor at reasoning. One of the claims that Mr. White makes is, pardon the little autofocus there, one of the claims that Mr. White makes is 1 John 5:7 is a Latin interpolation. In other words, it came over from the Latin text into the Greek text. What's his proof for this? He believes it. And so it is so. And this is kind of funny. If you listen to his July 28th podcast, he's made some rather stupid comments concerning those of us who hold to the Textus Receptus and the confessional view of Scripture. In minute 55, 38 through 45 seconds, he says that any reading of the TR is the correct reading of the TR because any reading of the TR is correct by definition. But that's not our position. That's an example of him lying about people who he disagrees with. You'll get used to it. I mean, anybody who's followed him knows that he's a chronic liar and bear a false witness. Yeah, that's wine. I might be doing some features on wine during the podcast from time to time. Can you see that? Oh, there we go. Skyfall. Merlot. Bought it in California. It's not bad. Anyways, the point of that is, let's go over some things that you would need to know in order to refute the claims of people like Dr. Michael Kruger, Daniel Wallace, Bart Ehrman, Peter Gurry, and Elijah Hickson, if textual criticism was actually a science. And I'll state right now, it is not a science. Anybody who claims it is doesn't actually understand the definition of the word science and what that means. I'll give you an example of a science. Computer science. Yeah, it's an actual science. Let's go with another one. Chemistry. Very simple. You do experiments, you test your experiments, you verify your experiments, and then you know if you actually have something. I'll give you an example of an experiment that was done, but people couldn't verify it, so it didn't become science. Cold fusion. Now, I know that some people may go, but it's real. Well, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. However, for it to be science, you had to verify the experiment, which means you have to produce repeatable results. You have to get the same result over and over using the same parameters as the original experiment. So how can textual criticism be a science? How do you get the same results over and over, providing you have the same parameters? You see what I'm saying? There is a problem there. Textual criticism keeps changing. We had the original version, which was John Goodwin's. That's the proto version. We'll call that the proto version. And that's covered in here in chapter 5. And my goal by the end of this month, into September 2020, is to have the entirety of the works of William Jenkin. There was another guy whose name escapes me right now, and John Goodwin, the Grand Heretic of England, to have their entire works turned into a series of blog posts with links going back and forth to show you what it is they were referring to in each other's letters, so you don't have to sit there, oh, well, can I remember that? No, because it's been a week since I read the last one, to make it easier so you can go back and forth. And what this will do is it'll help you to understand that the Reformers, contrary to claims from people like, yes, again, Mr. White, that given the material we have today, they would not have sided with those who hold to Restoration's textual criticism. They still would have condemned it as heresy and condemned those who practice it as heretics. Now, I know for some of you that seems to be very strong language, but I suggest you actually start reading on what the Reformers considered to be heresy. You see, there's heresy and there's damnable heresy. Damnable heresy would be, well, go to Matthew chapter 12, and you'll see what damnable heresy is. non-damnable heresy would be, us Baptists would consider the paedo-baptist view to be heresy, but not damnable heresy. And I would hope that the Presbyterians would think the same towards their Baptist brethren. Heresy, but not damnable heresy. In other words, I don't believe Presbyterians are going to hell because they hold a paedo-baptism, and the Presbyterians I know don't believe Baptists are going to hell because we hold to the biblical view of baptism. Yes, I said that. All right. But you might be thinking, okay, this is a nice little rambling. When are you getting to a real point? So let's break it down for you. How do you know that the New Testament text, called the Textus Receptus, and we can get in, I'll get into that in one of the later sections on what Textus Receptus, it's a stupid question when you think it through. You'll be surprised that anybody would ever ask that. But how do you know that the Textus Receptus and the Biblical Masoretic text, I'm probably not pronouncing that right, I don't really care, are the true Word of God? How do you know that the TR is the Word of God and that the critical texts, Nestle 28, or any of them, are corruptions of God's Word? How do you know this? What is your standard for evaluation? And this is where the critical text advocates lose. You see, the standard for evaluation for all truth is the same. It doesn't matter what it is. Whether you're dealing with the truth of chemistry, the truth of physics, the truth of geography, geometry, mathematics, computers, how you know something to be true, that standard that sits above everything else, well, that only comes from one source, the Word of God. In fact, I'm going to read to you something here shortly from a reformer that makes this abundantly clear to us. Okay. I have my little tablet in my hand here so that I can read this to y'all. And this is from Richard Capel's Remains. The book is at the website. If you go to the library tab and you click on the little down arrow, you'll see a preservationist textual criticism part. Preservationist textual criticism is what those of us who hold to the confessional view believe. So here's Richard Capel, a reformer. And it is agreed upon that in all learning, in the highest science of all, the principles are proving, but not proved. Now you might be saying, well, bloody hell, what does that even mean? That in all learning, this in textual criticism, the principles are proving, but not proved. In other words, the principles, the foundational way in which we view reality, for those of you who are presuppositionalists, our worldview, it's foundational. So what is to be the foundation for our worldview? Well, that should be obvious to anyone who claims to be a Christian, Scripture. Now, some of you might be thinking, that seems a little strange. You're telling me Scripture should be the foundation for textual criticism? Let's continue. For that which is the first cannot be proved by anything before it, else the first were not the first. As the first mover is never moved, and in all inferior sciences, the first principles of that science must be proved in a higher school. Now, the first principle in the school of Christ is the Scriptures. So, how do we know what the Scriptures are? Because Scripture tells us. Which, being the first, is to prove, not to be proved, but in a higher school, the school of heaven. In other words, the only place in which Scriptures can be proved to be Scriptures is in heaven. It cannot be done here on earth. So how do we know they're Scriptures? Because they say they're Scriptures. And I'll get to another one that it's expressed. It's a threefold expression that'll help you to understand this a little better. So, now, the first principle in the school of Christ is the Scriptures, which being the first is to prove, not to be proved, but in that higher school, the school of heaven, by evidences unprovable and unreprovable evidences taken from the prover and Spirit of God. Now that's Richard Capel. That is not the view held by the moderns, Warfield, Ford, or even Westcott and Hort. But I mentioned Warfield because he was reformed, supposedly. Westcott and Hort were not. They were lost. Now, people might say, oh, they weren't lost. How dare you say that about them? They were godly men. No. Those of you who believe that need to read their writings, their letters, which is also at the site of the RTC tab. They were heretics, damnable heretics, because they did not believe in the sufficiency of Christ. They believed in worshiping Mary. Look it up. Now, we're also going to go, remember that threefold part I mentioned to you. This is taken from Louis Gasson's Theonustia. That's also at the website, so you can read that as well. It's on page 136. The knowledge that we receive of the authority of the Scriptures has, for its objective cause, the Holy Bible itself, which proves its own divinity by its own beauty and by its own doings. In other words, man doesn't prove that Scripture is Scripture. Scripture by itself proves that it is the Word of God. For its subjective or efficient cause, the Holy Ghost, who confirms and seals to our souls the testimony of God. The Holy Ghost bears witness to what is true Scripture and what isn't. For its instrumental cause, the universal church. Now, that should scare James White. And it does. But it should scare all of us. You see, Scripture tells us what is Scripture. That's the first principle. The second principle that backs that up is, let's read it again, for its subjective or efficient cause, the Holy Ghost, who confirms and seals to our souls the testimony of God. Where we find the testimony of God in Scripture. The Holy Ghost bears witness to what is Scripture as well as Scripture itself. That's two witnesses. Now, in the mouth of two or more witnesses shall every word be established. But we have a third witness. The people of God throughout history, the universal church. Now in 1 Timothy 3:15, which is one of the verses, Louis Gasson, he's French, so I'm probably slaughtering his name. It reads, "But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth." And what is the truth? The Word of God. It's also the Holy Ghost. You'll read that in 1 John 5:6. You'll see that we are to be sanctified by the truth. In John 17:17, thy word is truth. And these type of verses have a very important meaning to us, because how can we be sanctified? How can we become, sorry for the little shaking Jake. Anyways, how can we know that we can be sanctified if we don't actually have the Word of God in its entirety? Well, we can't. You see, Psalm 119:9 tells us, "Wherewithal shall young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word." How are we going to cleanse our way? By taking heed to the Word of God. But if we don't have the Word of God in its entirety, and that means that we have it and nothing more, and nothing less. You don't veer to the left, you don't veer to the right, you go straight down the middle, and that is the Word of God. If we can't be assured that we have it with no addition and no subtraction, then we cannot be assured that we're properly sanctified, that we can even begin the process of sanctification. These are some of the logical ramifications that people on James White's side don't even think about. So, how do we know that we have the Word of God without addition and without subtraction? Simple. Scripture tells us we have the Word of God without addition and without subtraction. You doubt me? I'm glad you do. Makes me happy. So let's go and read what Scripture says. You'll have to pardon the glare. It's from my tablet. Isaiah 59:21. "As for me, this is my covenant with them, saith the Lord. My spirit that is upon thee, and my words which I put in thy mouth, shall not depart out of thy mouth, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, saith the Lord, from henceforth and forever." So if you hold to the Restoration's view of Scripture, like Dr. Kruger, Peter Gurry, Elijah Hickson, etc., then you are calling God a liar. That's blasphemy. Psalm 12, 6 and 7, the words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. Now some think verse 7 is referring to the people, as if that somehow negates the application to his word. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. How can he do that if his word isn't preserved as well? We are people of his word. If his word hasn't been kept pure in all ages, then we have no assurance of anything. We have no assurance of salvation. Matthew 5:18. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth shall pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Do you honestly think that the word of God could disappear in portions, that it can be corrupted by subtraction and addition until all of it is fulfilled? If you do, as the restorationist guys do, then you're calling Jesus Christ a liar. That's blasphemy. John 17:17, as I said before, sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. In order for his word to be truth, that has certain logical ramifications. One, there can be no corruption. Truth has no corruption in it. That means there can be no addition and there can be no subtraction. In other words, for us to be sanctified by his truth, which is a command of Christ, sanctify them through thy truth. That word is truth. God, Christ pleads with God the Father to sanctify us through his words. And we are commanded to be sanctified, which means we need his word. We need his truth without corruption. If we do not have it, then God cannot fulfill what Christ asked of him, God the Father. And for Christ to ask such a thing would mean that he is not God in the flesh. You see, the problems, the logical ramifications, and holding to the restorationist view, you have to believe certain things about God that are blasphemous. Now, they're not if you're an atheist. Romans 3, 1 through 2. What advantage then hath the Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision? Much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. The oracles of God is the word of God. And we already know we need it in its entirety in order to be sanctified by the truth. No corruption, no removal. Now, why do I keep harping on that? It's simple. If we're to be sanctified by the truth, and the truth is the word of God, which Scripture tells us it is, then you can have no corruption of the word of God. Because if you do, you cannot have sanctification by the truth because you don't have truth. Truth corrupted isn't truth. It's error. You see, this is the problem with the confession or the critical text view. Those who hold to the restorationist view believe that Scripture is in error. Now, they think, well, we're getting closer and closer. That's what James White believes. But actual textual critics no longer believe that they'll ever arrive at the original text. They doubt that's impossible, and they don't even care to. At best, they're looking at arriving at an earlier to late 2nd century text, maybe a 4th century text. Well, if that's the case, then why be a Christian? If God's text can't survive corruption, can't come to us uncorrupted, then why on earth would we think that God is real? Think about it. Let's say God's word, the Bible, God's word, let's say it actually is corrupted over time, as the restoration is sold to. What are the logical ramifications for that? No one can be sanctified. Now, those who hold to the restorationist view believe that the Textus Receptus is in error, and that the Reformers had a bad text. Well, that's the text they base their doctrine on. That also has certain logical ramifications. We have to go back through all the doctrines, We have to get rid of the confessions, the creeds, the catechisms, and we have to redo them based upon the new and better text. Think it through. The verses that are used to support the doctrine of the Trinity, the ones that the Arians wanted gone, are gone from the critical text. If we were to base our doctrine upon the critical text, we would arrive at Arianism and Gnosticism. And we'll go over this issue in later episodes. I think I prefer Merlot's to Cabernet Sauvignon's. 2 Corinthians 10, 4 through 5. Now this is a verse that many of you will be familiar with. Those of you who've read William Gurnall will especially be familiar with it. But this is two verses here. They destroy restorationist textual criticism. You cannot hold to it and hold to the truth of these two verses non-consistently. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. That's something RTC advocates do not do. They do not bring their views, their beliefs about Scripture, their thoughts about Scripture, their thoughts about textual criticism to the obedience of Christ. And how do we obey Christ? We go to His Word. That's the only way we can know how to obey Him. So, after about 30 minutes of talking, we've come to it. The way we know Scripture is Scripture is because Scripture tells us it's so. The objective, absolute, and invariant standard by which we evaluate the Greek manuscripts and their variants, Scripture. There is nothing else. You see, this is the difference between the restorationist view and those of us who hold to the confessional view, the biblical view. Those on the restorationist side believe that their autonomous human reasoning, their minds, can evaluate the evidence and determine what is and isn't Scripture, independent of the teaching of Scripture. You doubt me? That is what James White has said for the last couple of years. Back in October 2015, and I'll put this up on the site again, there was a crash back in March. Never really recovered because I wasn't able to save everything, but I think I have that and I can put it back up. But in the Facebook group, the so-called Reformed Pub, it's not Reformed, James White was there and on a thread about Mark 16. He made a couple of foolish claims, one that you'll find hilarious in light of the upcoming debate. He actually claimed, well, there's no papyri evidence for the longer ending of Mark. Yeah, none of the papyri actually deal with Mark 16. You see, the statement is correct, but it has no bearing on the argument. Yes, the papyri do not support Mark 16, the longer ending. They don't support the shorter ending. They don't support the shorter reading. They don't support anything. That's how you lie with evidence. James White should give a masterclass in deceit, for he is an expert in it. The other one, and personally, I find these things funny. Now, we'll cover in a later episode why it isn't a science and why calling it a science is actually a, well, it, there is no better word for it but to call it lying. And here was his way of reasoning. When I pointed out that the way that we are to evaluate Greek manuscripts and their variants is by going to the Scriptures to see what the Scripture says about how we should do that, his reasoning, or his comment was, well, you're just engaging in circular reasoning. You're appealing to Scripture to determine Scripture. Duh! Well, what else would you appeal to? What is higher than Scripture in the life of the Christian than Scripture? Nothing according to Scripture. Let me read it again, the latter part of 2 Corinthians 10, 4 and 5. and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. How do you bring a thought into the obedience of Christ? You pair it with the Word of God. If the thought is consistent with Scripture, it is obedient to Christ. If it is inconsistent with Scripture, it is disobedient to Christ and is therefore sin. For as we know from Romans, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. And how do we know whether or not it's of faith? Because it is found in the Word of God, either expressly stated or derived as a principle. Now, can you derive the principles of textual criticism from the Word of God? Absolutely not. That's not where it came from. It didn't come from the Word of God. It came from autonomous human reasoning. So what is it that restorationist advocates are doing from the time of John Goodwin to today? They are engaged in the very same thing that occurred in the Garden of Eden. They're putting forth their own human reasoning as more authoritative than Scripture. They are striving to become God himself. That is what Dr. Michael Kruger, Peter Gurry, Elijah Hickson, Dan Wallace, Bart Ehrman, James White, etc. are all doing. They are striving to make themselves God in the place of Jehovah. That's blasphemy and sin. It's also idolatry, and it is heresy. Because when you teach something that is false, you are teaching heresy and you become a heretic. Why do you think there are warnings in Scripture about teaching? And you might say, well, what about you? Aren't you? No, I'm not teaching. All I'm doing is I'm giving you the information from godly men who have gone before. There's nothing new on this subject. The issues are simple. Scripture and Scripture alone determines how we are to evaluate Scripture and to evaluate the variants. James White and others, and remember, James White has stated this twice, October 2015, and after I pointed out to him that all appeals to final authority are inherently circular, and he should know that as a so-called presuppositionalist, he fled the pub for a few months. I don't blame him. I mean, it didn't take much to disprove him, but on July 28th, on his dividing line, and it began, so you don't have to listen to all the crap, at minute 47 or so, he again states that textual criticism should not have Scripture as its foundation. Well, there is no other foundation upon which to build. Does he not remember what the Scriptures say? Let me pause and I'll bring it up for you. Alrighty, looks like we're going again. Matthew chapter 7. Let's go through this. Verse 24. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man, which buildeth his house upon a rock. In other words, you have to listen to what Christ teaches and build upon that. Does Christ in his word teach the principles which underlie restorationist textual criticism? No, he does not. Therefore, you cannot build upon those principles and arrive at truth. Remember, only Scripture is truth. Now, some of you might be upset with that statement. Well, I mean, there's other truths out there. No. Scripture is the standard by which we evaluate all truth claims. If it is consistent with Scripture, it is true. If it is inconsistent with Scripture, it is false. Now, we know that the restorationist textual criticism claims are inconsistent with Scripture, therefore they are false. And we'll go over that later. Right now, my goal is to get you through understanding the main issue. This isn't an issue over manuscripts or variants. This is an issue over how we approach the evidence. You see, all evidence is interpreted evidence, but the method by which we are obligated and commanded, lest we sin as Christians, to interpret evidence, and not just textual evidence, evidence about the world. This goes to evolution as well. The only standard by which we are allowed to evaluate truth claims is Scripture. That's it. That is why the lost are lost. They reject Scripture, and so they cannot definitively know whether something is true. Now, you might say, well, you know, unbelievers are always able to understand the truth. I mean, they can know things that are true and not true. Yeah, sure. But an unbeliever cannot give an account for why something is true. You see, an unbeliever can say that 2 + 2 = 4. And he can make good arguments for it. But there is no definitive truth claim that he can make. Think about it. How does he know that it'll always be 4 in the future? He doesn't. He doesn't know what the future holds. How do we Christians know it'll always be true in the future? Simple. We have the Word of God, and the Word of God is always true and has been kept pure in all ages, so that we know that what we're reading in the authentic Greek and Hebrew texts of the Reformers, that is the Word of God. That tells us that as long as the earth continues, you know, unless Christ returns, that 2 + 2 = 4. Now, how do I know this? Let me go ahead and pause again and I'll look this up, then I'll come back to Matthew 7:13. All right, recording again. Here we are in Genesis chapter 8, verse 21. Verse 22. How do we know that 2 + 2 will always = 4? While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. Now, if God did not keep his word pure in all ages, then we have no confidence in that statement in Scripture, and we have no confidence that 2 + 2 will = 4 in the future. Might equal it today, might not tomorrow. That's the difference. Now let's go back to Matthew chapter 7. Give me a second here as I go through. Dead air. All right. Anyways, as I say in verse 24, those who hear his sayings, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not, now, this is important, pay attention to this, shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. What an absolutely meaningless statement by Jesus, if his word is not kept pure in all ages. How can we build upon his word and have confidence that we are building upon a rock if his word has changed, if his word has been corrupted as the restoration is held to? We have no assurance. That is an important issue that you have to consider. And that's why I say the issue has nothing to do with manuscripts or variants. It has to do with the method of evaluating manuscripts and variants. And that method can only be Scripture, regardless of what people like James White claim. Well, you're just being circular, which is a foolish claim by him, as he claims to be a suppositionalist and a follower and a past friend of James or Dr. Greg Bonson. So therefore he knows that all appeals to final authority are inherently circular. And what was his appeal to final authority? Was it Scripture? Absolutely not. James White's final authority is not Scripture. It is his own autonomous reasoning. And that is the same for Dr. Michael Kruger, Peter Gurry, Elijah Hickson, Dan Wallace. Everyone who holds to the restorationist view, from the heretic John Goodwin to the heretic B.B. Warfield to the modern heretics, all of them make their own reasoning more authoritative than God's word. That's blasphemy and idolatry, and it is heresy to teach it, and that is what they do. And as Christians, we need to move away from that and move back to the way the Reformers thought, the pre-Enlightenment thinking, that Scripture and Scripture alone gives us the foundation for evaluating all truth claims. I know whether or not something is true or false, not because a scientist said it, but because it either comports with or disagrees with Scripture. That's it. And how do I know what Scripture is? How do I know which verse is correct and which verse isn't? Scripture tells me. You see, Scripture gave me the principles by which to evaluate the Greek manuscripts and their variants, and I read them to you. The first principle by which we evaluate all truth claims, Scripture itself. So Scripture determines what is Scripture. We don't. We receive that determination. The second, the Holy Ghost bearing witness to us what is Scripture. Why do you think after decades, centuries of people claiming 1 John 5:7 isn't Scripture, the Christians still hold to it? The witness of the Holy Ghost. We know it is the Word of God because Scripture tells us it is the Word of God, because the Holy Ghost bears witness to it being the Word of God, and lastly, because the universal church, Christians throughout the history of Christendom, bear witness to it being the Word of God. And who are those who are the ones who wanted to get rid of it? Well, like Erasmus, they were the anti-Trinitarians, blasphemers, idolaters, the wicked, the heretics. So, is getting rid of 1 John due to manuscript evidence? No. You see, there is no manuscript evidence for 2 Peter 3:10's Greek word ouk, not. None. No Greek manuscript evidence. There are a lot of verses in the critical text in which there is no Greek manuscript evidence. So it's not the Greek manuscript evidence that is the final determiner. If it was, then people on the critical text side would affirm the latter ending of, you know, the last 12 verses of Mark, the woman taken in adultery, and other such passages. Manuscript evidence has nothing to do with it. Anybody who claims that it does is a liar. It is the way they reason. Is Scripture the foundation for their truth claims? Or is their own autonomous reasoning the foundation for their truth claims? And I'm afraid this is the problem with the upcoming debate between Dr. Riddle and Mr. White. I'm not really sure it's a good idea to debate someone like James White. And Dr. Riddle, to be fair, has mentioned his own concerns about whether it'd be valuable because of Mr. White's tendency to lie, to obfuscate, to be deceitful. But the reality is, James White doesn't know what he's talking about because he doesn't believe Scripture is authoritative over everything. You see, if Scripture is to be what Scripture commands itself to be, the method by which we evaluate everything, then that means necessarily it is the method by which we are to evaluate the Greek manuscripts and their variants. So when I have two texts, one that has Ephesians 3:9 and one that doesn't, how do I know which one is true? Which one comports with Scripture? Which one comports with the testimony of the Holy Ghost throughout the history of the universal church? Well, based on those three criteria, the biblical criteria, Ephesians 3:9 is Scripture, and those who reject it, well, they reject the Word of God. What do you call someone that rejects the Word of God and thinks that they're more godly than God, or more wise, or wiser? Yeah, it's just foolishness. And that's the way we should approach this entire subject. You see, Dr. Leetus, Theodore Leetus, made a compelling argument years ago before he died, that in order to approach this issue, now he was talking specifically at this time about the independent fundamentalist Baptists who were on the side of the TR but didn't really know much, and he had legitimate concerns about them. But he had made comments that we need a thorough history of church history, a thorough knowledge, a thorough understanding, a historical understanding, a good grasp of church history from zero to the reformers. You see, without that, then you really don't know how to evaluate Greek manuscripts, he claimed. You would need to know, you know, the works of the reformers. You'd have to know all of them that dealt with Scripture. No one on the Restoration side knows that, and very few of us on the Confessional side know anything like that. The last person who truly did died, Dr. Garnet Milne. I mean, he wrote that wonderful book. Let me hold it up again. Oh, there we go. Anyways, stuff like that, knowing church history, fluency with the writings of the reformers on the doctrine of Scripture, all of their writings and their interactions with the Romans and with heretics like John Goodwin, fluency in Latin and ancient Greek. See, these are things that no one has. Let's see here. Not just familiarity, but knowledge of the writings of the church fathers. Augustine stated that the pericope adulterae was removed in order to keep women from committing adultery. But James White says, well, he doesn't know what he's talking about. Why? The reason that's never stated by Mr. White, the reason Augustine didn't know what he was talking about? Because Augustine's idea disagrees with Mr. White's idea. But which one's consistent with Scripture? Only that of Augustine. Anyways, another issue that you would need, that Dr. Lee has brought up, it's a legitimate issue that's lacking in modern Christendom, critical thinking skills. But you don't need any of that in order to easily refute any restorationist textual critic advocate. All you need to do is ask one simple question. What is your universal, absolute, invariant standard for evaluating Greek manuscripts and their variants? Unless they say the Word of God, then they've lost, because they have nothing else to appeal to but their own subjective human reasoning. And what truth claims they make have no value to you. Let me give you an example of why. Let's go back to World War II, Nazi Germany. The Nazis believe that the Jews should be exterminated. Okay, why were the Nazis wrong? Non-Christians have no legitimate answer. Only Christians have a legitimate answer. You cannot murder people. Why? Because God says, thou shalt not kill. The Nazis murdered Jews. Therefore they sin. Therefore it's wrong. That is how we know right from wrong. And that is how we evaluate all truth claims. You see, we can't evaluate truth claims based upon what we think is right and what we think is wrong, because the Germans thought it was right to exterminate Jews. What makes their view less authoritative than the view of someone who thinks that what they're doing is wrong? Unless you have an absolute, universal, invariant authority to which you can appeal to, which must come from outside mankind, you have nothing. You don't have any way to justify your truth claim. You might be right, but you have no way of knowing you're right. And that's the other problem with restorationist view of Scripture. Let's say that they were actually able to recreate the autographic text. How would they know they did it? They wouldn't. You see, there's no way that they can verify their textual criticism work. Why? Well, they reject what Scripture teaches about self-preservation. That's out. They can claim they hold to a generic preservation, as James White does, but that's a meaningless doctrine. That's the same preservation that attends the writings of Plato and Cicero. There's nothing. Okay. Well, what else do they have to justify their truth claims? Their own reasoning? What they think is true? Well, what if I disagree with them? What makes them more authoritative? Oh, they've studied more. No, that doesn't make them more authoritative. That just means they studied more. You've made an assumption that studying more makes your truth claim more authoritative. What is your verification? How do you verify that? How do you justify that? You see, that's the problem. Because they rely on their own reasoning, when you ask them questions, they have to keep going back and back and back and back and back. And they get never stop. When they ask us, well, you know, how do you verify it? Simply, we go to Scripture. We look at the principles taught in Scripture. Scripture determines what is truth. Scripture determines which text we should use and which we shouldn't. Which is why I can say that Vaticanus and Sinaiticus are artifacts of historical significance, but they have no bearing on the text of Scripture. In fact, any manuscript we find that differs from the Greek and Hebrew texts of the Reformers, well, they're corruptions. How do I know this? Simple. Scripture tells me so. And that's what James White can't understand when he's always saying, well, you have different standards of... No. We don't have different standards of evaluation. We have one. We have an overarching principle. Scripture determines itself. And that is completely different than Mr. White's view, which is autonomous human reasoning determines what a scripture is and then submits to its authority. Well, that's a joke. That makes man into God. And that is the exact sin that we have in the Garden of Eden. All right, in this section, we would normally discuss a book review or a book analysis, such as, has the Bible been kept pure? The Westminster Confession of Faith and the Providential Preservation of Scripture. And in upcoming episodes, we'll actually go over this book chapter by chapter. That might seem a little long, but you'll find that it's worth it to go over it. And give me an example of what we'll do is the introduction covers Warfield and what he taught. Then we move on to John Calvin on possessing the complete scriptures in word and doctrine. Then the immediate theological context of the assembly. How did the 17th century Puritans understand the purity of the extant original language text of the scripture? Then chapter 4, the role of providence in the preservation of scripture in all ages. See, without it being preserved in all ages, without any addition, without any loss, then you have no idea if what you have truly is scripture. No one does. If that's the case. Chapter 5. And this is where you'll find articles on the site in the next couple weeks. And hopefully by next week you'll see the first of them, and which will deal with John Goodwin, the Grand Heretic of England, William Jenkin, and John Vickers, and how they responded to him. We'll also cover other people like William Ames, Augustine, Daniel Chamier, John White of Eccles, William Whitaker, Nicholas Byfield, and Solomon Glassius. And chapter 5 is Discordant Views, the Interesting Case of the Unconventional John Goodwin. Unconventional. James Usher on the Purity of the Original Language Text of Scripture. And something you should understand, James Usher's views on Scripture were essentially the foundation for the Westminster and London Baptist views on Scripture. And 7, a biblical summary of the Reformed religious epistemology. You see, and that's really what we're talking about when we talk about textual criticism, epistemology. How do we know what we know? And how do we know it's true? And those of us who hold to the confessional view believe that only Scripture can provide that. Those who hold to the restorationist view believe that human reasoning provides that. And that's the essential difference. And there are other, you know, nuances. For instance, the Restorationist view began to be codified after John Goodwin by Richard Simon, the Jesuit, as part of the Counter-Reformation, an attack on the doctrine of sola scriptura, because if you could undermine sola scriptura, which you do by attacking scripture, as textual critics do, then you undermine the Reformation. Now, normally in the FAQ section, we would deal with stuff like, well, which Textus Receptus is the real Textus Receptus? The answer, oh, they're all the Textus Receptus. Well, what about Erasmus? Why did he remove 1 John 5:7? Why did he include that? I'd heard about his myth, the wager myth. Well, in this section, we'll deal with those issues. To deal with that just immediately, if you go to the website on the Theodore Letus page, you'll see his work on Erasmus. Erasmus was an anti-Trinitarian. That's why he left out 1 John 5:7. In this section, I'll give you recommendations of books that you'll find useful, audios, videos, debates, etc. For today, there's one series that I highly recommend. It's put out by John Greer of Ballymena Presbyterian Church, and it's called The Holy Scripture. And you can find it at Sermon Audio. Just type in John Greer, that's two E's, and The Holy Scripture. It's easy to find. And I'll put a link in the description of this video and also on the website. Well, that concludes the first episode of the Confessional Bibliology podcast. Hopefully you found some of it useful and I didn't ramble on too long. Going forward, in the next episode, and for quite a few, we're going to be covering the main views found in this book by Dr. Garnet Milne. And I'll also be posting books in the website or on the website that correspond to the books that are found in each chapter, the ones that I can find that are freely available. They'll be on the site for free so that you can actually read where Dr. Milne quotes from and see that in context, he's not misrepresenting anyone. And that's an important thing to understand. He's not misrepresenting what you find out there. He's accurately representing it. And that makes his argument all the stronger. Anyways, that's the Confessional Bibliology podcast. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope everyone has a good week. And until next time, talk to you later.